its terrible destruction had opened possibilities of great discovery. Young men and women scrambled to be educated. Science was heroic, fascinating, and supported. The atom now divided was tantalizing, and the universe full of new explanations for old mysteries. These bright, young, intellectual immigrants gravitated to prominent universities and to science and engineering centers like Oak Ridge, a place with welcoming facilities, creative leadership, energetic technical workers, and importantly, resources to fund new ideas. They rode the wave of a new golden era of scientific exploration, which was to thrive for over half a century, and today reaches outward in 1,000 directions. From this wealth of talent emerged advances in nuclear power, medicine, safety, genetics, man-made elements, neutron exploration, materials, robotics, high-speed computing, and space exploration. We honor with this music the accomplishments of a generation of science and engineering pioneers. Driven by curiosity and passion, these once young men and women challenged the edges of discovery. And the wave continues, and the sky is the limit.
Thank you. So I brought that. I thought I'd share with Karen some early photos. And I always think it's fun to see, you know, you have these old-fashioned photos, but then you have the next generation. So this is me and my brothers and sister. Right there. And my little one-quarter Greek children. But the reason I share that is because I think it's a personal story for all of us, that this is part of how our country developed. I was telling Nikki and a few others earlier about my brother's Greek godmother, who is kind of the person who I remember the most. And her husband had gone back to Greece to, he had been promised one of his friend's daughters to be his wife, to take to America. And they had a bunch of kids, and so the oldest daughter was going to go to America with Gus, his name was. And so he got there with his dollar bills and his coffee and his chocolate, which made him pretty hot property in Greece at that time. And the little girl was scared, and she hid behind her mother's skirts. She said, "I don't want to go." And the little sister peeked out and said, "I'll go." And so that kind of bravery is what our country is made of. A lot of people who said, "I'll go." And I think that's really important. So we've been, you know, as this project has developed, and we've talked about that, so many people have shared their stories with me, and that has made it really rich. Many different stories. People, my wife was talking to me, and she asked her aunt about the earliest ancestor that she had, and a Banfield Cape Wren who came in the 1700s was evidently a stowaway, but that still makes her like VAR worthy, you know. So, and others too. Nikki, Evelyn, who's our stage manager, was telling me backstage how her family, they were immigrating, and of course somebody, this is, you know, before cell phones or anything, right, in the 50s and the 40s. And, you know, they showed up at the harbor, and they were citizens, you know, by family, and nobody was there, you know. And so this kind of risk-taking and adventure and the spirit of things, all the way down to my good friend Theodore here, whose name used to be Ethan until he was granted citizenship 3 years ago. So if you want to quiz him. We all have different stories, and we live in a great country, and it's fun to remember that. So sit back and enjoy this wonderful piece that tells one of the great stories of our country.
He had two uncles who came here when they were young men. And right after World War I, they wrote to us and asked if we wanted to come to America. But they couldn't send me the whole family. They just sent the three of us, my father and I, and my younger brother. I was dreaming about it. I was writing to my uncles and I said, I wish one day I'll be in America. We're supposed to get on second class. We were in the third class because so many people were going to America because they opened the doors for everyone right out of the door. It was very, very crowded. It was absolutely terrible, and I was sick the whole time. I was very, very sick. I said to my father, take me on the deck and throw me into the ocean because I can't stand it. And finally, we got here.
James, I never said to go or not to go.
very proud as men of their own minds go to America. I know you're going to have a better life in America than we have here. And then he left, and he was crying. He was crying. Do you know how I felt when I left my home, my father, and my mother? I was the first in my family to come to the United States. I was in third class. $75 for the ticket. There was three in the cabin. I was on the bottom bunk, and this man named Gus and his father were on top of me. The trip was 22 days on the ocean. We arrived in New York and saw the Statue of Liberty. And Gus asked me, "But what's that statue?" And then we're looking at the statue, and his father says, "Well, that's Christopher Columbus." And I put my 2 cents out, and I said, "Listen, that does not look like Christopher Columbus. That's a lady thing." They started examinations on Ellis Island. And I was brought alongside Gus, and I noticed that he had a chalk mark on his back. I couldn't reach my back, so I asked him, "Do I have a chalk mark on my back?" So he looked, and he said, I said, "You've got one." And I'm thinking either he goes back to Greece or I go back to Greece. So what happened? The one with the chalk mark went back to Greece. He had to go back. I don't know why. I just pray, "Dear Lord, and thank God that I was admitted to the United States of America without a chalk mark on my back."
Thank you.
vacation in 1936 and were married soon after. By 1940, the war was coming closer to Belgium, and I had a feeling that the Germans would have to go through Belgium to get to France. I kept on saying to Paul, "We have to leave." From Belgium, we went to Lisbon, and we stayed there about 3 months. We couldn't get a boat. My husband Paul, his whole family got killed. His father, mother, two sisters, a brother, who was married with a wife and two daughters. They all got killed in Poland. He was the only survivor. If you hate, you lose yourself. There's nothing left in this world after hate. I can't hate. I've never been taught to even after the bombs, even after all that happened in our town. My father tried to explain. I was 10 years old. I asked that question. Why? There was no answer to it. There still isn't.
My bachelor uncle was 11, and my grandmother lived with us. 12 people. boy slept four in a bed, toe to toe. The girl slept three in a bed. We were poor people, but not dirt poor. We were bored, but we ate. In 1921, my father died, and my Uncle Jack assumed command of the family. He said, "We can't go on. The economy is nothing. We're all going to America." But we didn't go all at once. Finally, in 1925, I came with my sister. I was 19. I had no ties and looked forward to America as an adventure. My brother Lou had gone to America the year before. He was writing, telling me about all the wonderful things he was doing as a cowboy and how he was with the Barnum and Bailey Circus. I knew so little about America. For me, America was cowboys and Indians and streets paved with gold. I only have the good news, you understand? I left the port of Liverpool with my sister. I arrived in New York Harbor August 1st. I remember I heard the lookout say, "Land ahoy!" Everybody rushed up on deck to land, the first sign of America. I remember rushing up. I couldn't see a goddamn thing. I mean, the horizon was the same.
Thank you. From her beacon hand glows worldwide love.